Well, thank you for coming. This is a Love Your Library event for 2017. We usually have a few, most 2, 3, 4 a year. And it's something that we try to work with, real things that will really interest you, that will help your studies or your life in some way. So I really appreciate your coming. And I'm going to go through a couple of thank yous and then talk a little bit about this current situation. So I need to thank my teammates, Jennifer Mack and Matthew Michaels, who helped pull all this together. Steve Croder of designersandbooks.com, who helped promote this, and he's here if you want to talk to him. And Paula Kelly, who worked for Ginkgo Press, who was able to get me in touch with Catherine. The book. Okay, so the status of the book. When I first asked Catherine, the book was supposed to be out, and this was supposed to be a book signing. So now it's a forthcoming book talk. We don't have them, but she brought her copies. She brought her copies to look through, so you can actually go and look through the book. That's why those sheets are out there, and also contact sheet if you want to keep in touch with her or have her notify you about the book, et cetera. And I would urge you to look through the book. It is listed in Amazon as available at May 1st. Okay, so that's what that is. Now I need to thank Catherine, because Catherine has come here all the way from Australia, which is really amazing. And we tried to get her, well, when I asked her, she said, well, I'm going to be busy. Can I come like in, January or February or something? I'm like, no, it's not good for the academic calendar, you know, because she was busy. And she said yes. And then I only found out she was busy because she just got married the week before coming to New York. So she's here on her honeymoon. And that's her wonderful husband, Daniel, with their baby, Ruby. So Ruby can take over later. Okay, so that was two things. The third thing I need to thank her for is because she really asked what we wanted her to focus on, because it really covers a lot of programs. So we spoke, and I asked her to do one New York boutique hotel, so she picked what she felt was the best one. And then I asked her to do sustainability, because that's so big here. You know, it's also in the programs. And then the other one is I really wanted to get a hotel that brought all of the branding down to the product, down to the graphics and advertising, all of that. So she's chosen good examples. Obviously, there's a lot more in her book. And she also, being from Australia, has worked all these years in a different part of the world and has a lot more experience than this talk. So feel free to ask her anything. So I am just going to read this because I'm not going to remember her bio otherwise. So Catherine is a graphic designer and writer with over 10 years' experience working in Asia, Europe, and Australia. She holds a Bachelor of Design from Monash University, and she is completing her Master's in Entrepreneurship and Innovation. So that's, you know, ask away. And then Stay With Me, her book is published by Ginkgo Press, and it actually has been featured in Modern Living, Modern Luxury magazine, and it's just been put into Vogue Living Australia, so, and it's not even out yet. So that's just the beginning for her. So thank you, Catherine, and you want to start?
Hi. Thank you for the introduction, Jane. All right, so I know that quite a few of you from different areas, whether it's product design, graphic design, so hopefully this should cover quite a few of those topics for you. So a little bit about me, not much. So as Jane just mentioned, so Bachelor of Design from Monash actually studied arts law before that and then changed into design. So I'm sort of an eternal student, I think, and now doing my Masters of Entrepreneurship and Innovation. So the idea for this book actually came from when I was at university, and we had to do an assignment about branding and how that could be applied. I've always had a fascination with hotels, so therefore I thought I'll design some stationery for a hotel, made up, and from that realised, actually, what are my reference points here? Who am I looking at? Gee, there's some actual really interesting hotels that are doing some really creative things. So from that, that's sort of where I also came up or thought of the idea, where's the sort of book that I can look to as a reference or that shows or demonstrates how hotels are displaying their collateral. So that's how the idea was born. And then I put together a proposal. I've put a couple of screenshots here just for those of you who are interested in what a proposal would look like from the publishing perspective. So pretty much here I put together a collection of ideas of what I thought would be included in the book, what the content would include, and a short list of some of the hotels, which I think you'll see from the bottom right there are some of the initial spreads of what I came up with in terms of designing, which was probably the hardest thing to do being a designer as to how you'd actually like to design your own book. Then came to the research. So this was really the fun part. So I think, as discussing before, I think it's about nearly 31 hotels in about 34 days. So it was 10 countries. 10 countries, 34 days. It was a whirlwind trip. So I started in Melbourne. I'll see some of the locations there. So Melbourne to New York, Chicago, London, Oslo, Stockholm, Amsterdam, Berlin, Vienna, Zurich, Paris and Singapore, and then made it back home. So it was a very quick trip, but very good in terms of being able to meet with not only the owners, sometimes it was the owners of the hotel, sometimes it was the PR company that was related to it, sometimes it was the creatives themselves who did all the designs. So yeah, in terms of that, every hotel, speaking to the actual people who are I guess behind the scenes of that hotel was a really interesting way of learning more about not only hotels but how their marketing and branding works. Writing and designing the book, pretty self-explanatory of a lot of iterations, but obviously gets you to the published book, which is on its way. It's a longer process than what was expected. But yeah, I hope you all get to have a look at the book. And if anyone has any questions or wants to contact me, you can get my details through Jane, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Yeah, perfect. Okay, so I thought I'd go through a couple of case studies just as it's more of an interesting way of showcasing what some of the hotels have done. So Nomad, I thought, was an interesting one. I'm not sure whether many of you may have heard of it here already. So north of Madison Square Park. So built in 1903. So the hotel identity and the art program that they have is based on this idea of the voyage. So the interiors you'll see there from a French designer, Jacques Garcia, and he basically put together all of the rooms themselves based on his childhood memories of growing up. So in that sense, the interiors have mahogany French writing desks, embossing. It's very luxurious, it's very high-end, and it's just a very sophisticated application, I guess, of interior products together. They obviously as well have their restaurant there and their bar, which is also well known. So here's the building here if you don't know it already. So looking at the branding for here, I think it's an interesting way of, it's quite simple and it's a quite simplified application with a monogram. So B Poles was the studio who created the design, and they have studios here in Paris and in New York. So you'll see from these, I think the experience you get from the Nomad is a very different experience to the next hotel, which I'll discuss, which is why I wanted to put these two together. And that you'll see this is very luxurious. It's quite a traditional, you walk into the hotel, someone will take your luggage upstairs for you, you'll check in at the reception desk, and then you'll head to your room. So in that sense, here's a couple of the shared spaces. But in terms of shared spaces, I think it's quite limited. I think it's still based predominantly on the idea that you're still going to check into a hotel traditionally and head to your room and then sleep, go out the next day, and not spend as much time within the hotel itself. So you'll see here the artwork, and a lot of the artwork, I think, is an interesting idea or within hotels of how they're bringing in artwork and how they display their artwork within the hotels. So like I said, this one was all based on original drawings, and I think they actually sell them now in their own books that are displayed within the hotel. Other hotels, I was just thinking there's one of the hotels in the book is The Thief, which is in Oslo, and they're associated with the museum, which is right next door. So there, they have a full-time art curator on staff that actually changes the artwork on a daily basis in some instances. And I think it's something ridiculous in terms of the actual artwork they have is about... I think it's worth around $50 million or something like that, the actual artwork that they have on display within the hotel. So I guess the point of that is, you know, how hotels are actually interacting with art is becoming more important as to how they can change things, how they engage with their guests, how they move forward towards the future with creating a sense of space for people. So looking here at the collateral, you'll see it's very simple. And I guess in a way, the traditional approach for branding would be to create a logo, create an icon, put them together and then sort of slap it on everything and say, there you go, there's your brand. Which I think is problematic, and I think it's that sort of formulaic approach is what's sort of making all of these boutique hotels change and do something different. So I guess the reasoning behind why it's these hotels rather than other hotels that I chose, you know, you can go to the Hilton, it will look the same, the stationery will be the same, the signage will be the same, it will all look the same no matter where you go, which to me I think is, you know, it has a purpose for those clientele, but in terms of the brands that are becoming more interesting these days, and you'll notice even those big brands are starting their own sub-brands, which is the boutique hotels, which is appealing to the millennials who are going to be going to, you know, who want to go to a hotel that's slightly more interesting, that, you know, appeals to them. And I think that's one thing that's really interesting about sort of these luxury brands or the bigger name hotels, and that you'll see more and more of them are creating these smaller sub-brands. Sorry, I go on random weird tangents sometimes. So again, the stationery for the nomad. So some of it has a little, you know, there's slight conversational tone, but most of it is quite quite traditional, yet very different, I guess, to if you were staying at, say, the Marriott or one of those hotels. Okay, so this one is in contrast. Have you all heard of Citizen M? There is one here in Times Square. So Citizen M, I think, is a really interesting case study, really interesting way that they've applied branding. You'll see here, this is just from the initial hoarding that they put up for one of their hotels in London. So initially, without even, I guess, seeing any of the hotel, you instantly have a collection of images, whether it's from Instagram, images put together of these are the people. You have conversational tone, you have, you know, lowercase trying to be friendlier. I think initially, even from this, it demonstrates the power of branding within hotels. So a couple of the other welcome to the new kind of hotel designed for explorers, adventurers and mobile citizens like you. So I'm not sure whether you know much about Citizen M, but they started in Amsterdam in, I think it was 2008. And it's sort of a move away from, or I guess I should go back a little bit. So in New York in sort of the, I think it was 1975, so Ian Schrager created the Morgan's Hotel Group, which sort of became, okay, this is a different hotel, it's becoming more boutique. And by boutique in that sense, it's a more intimate space, a more personalized experience. I think that was what was trying to be conveyed. Following that to today, I guess you get more of these lifestyle hotels is popular. I guess it's the new term, the updated boutique. And in conjunction with that, there's also now a form of eco-luxury hotels, which is more of the high-end luxurious accommodation that's also trying to make sure that they do good for the planet at the same time. So you'll see, I think, I'll discuss it a little bit later within sustainability, but just to put into context. So Citizen M was more for the budget traveller, or I guess not necessarily just for the budget traveller, but for people who wanted to, okay, go to a hotel, use it just to sleep, but use the space. So the space became more important. So whether it was downstairs, the bar, all of the areas that were shared spaces became the most important elements to the hotel. So in that sense, it sort of changed, and you'll see a lot more of them now have really, you know, embraced that idea that, okay, you're not just going to a hotel to sleep. You want to share that space. You want to go to the hotel as a destination. And Citizen M, I would say, is one of those hotels that's more of a destination of just going to the place and experiencing it. It's quite low budget in terms of accommodation to stay there. All of the rooms are prefabricated and built off site, so that's how they can keep their prices low. So they bring all of the rooms sort of assembled, pre-assembled. And all of the rooms are exactly the same. So there's no sort of hierarchy in, you know, I'd like the corner suite that has the, you know, four-man spa or So again here, so Citizen M, choosing a hotel that's 400 metres from here and a million miles from the Hilton. So I guess that cheekiness, it's definitely cheekiness and playing on the fact that the guests that would necessarily stay at the Hilton won't be the ones staying at Citizen M, even though now they might be. And also with Citizen M, it's about technology. So things that, you go. Yeah, that's a really good point. Yeah, I think, so what I was saying in relation to, say, the Hilton, generally people would check in and the only time you would see another guest was when you were having breakfast the next morning. Whereas, yeah, Citizen M is obviously very much similar to Ace Hotel now. I guess the probably more relevant, I guess, now is what are the kind of type of guests you're attracting to these places. So I think there's that fine line of, Citizen M is more of your, I say budget, but at the same time it's sort of, boutique budget. Whereas other places, I know, I was looking at One Brooklyn that has just opened this week in Dumbo. And, they have a similar thing with the shared spaces. So it's an interesting dynamic as to how they can cater to different genders, different ages, different travellers, whether you're business, whether you're like you were just going on a holiday and you're young and you want to sort of, I guess, elevate from a backpacking experience to actually staying somewhere. But yeah, it's a really interesting point. So you'll see here, so these are some of the common shared spaces. And I think another thing that Citizen M does is collaborates with, they have their own bookstore within the hotel. So one of the bookstores, Mendo, which is, they're actually based in Amsterdam, they actually sell their products through the hotel. So again, it's this collaboration of hotels bringing these exterior, whether it's not only interior designers, but it's local designers, it's also art installations, it's bookstores, it's bringing these design elements into the hotel and how I guess they assign themselves relevance to the local neighbourhood. So this is the room for Citizen M. So as I mentioned earlier, technology is really huge with the hotel. You can actually, which I guess in that way, the sustainability element is that checking in, it's all paperless. You actually check in on a kiosk and there is someone there. They call them ambassadors rather than their staff. So there is someone there to help you, but most of it you can do yourself. Once you're in your room, the personalization, it will come up with a message on the TV saying, "Welcome, Catherine." There's an iPad in every room. You control the lighting. You control the colour of the lighting, you control music, you basically do all of that, the blinds from your iPad. The other thing I think with their branding is these characters. So you'll see the one there that's at the end of the hallway. They've created these characters that sort of tell their story, and it's that next step of interacting with guests, which is why I say you'll notice the nomad's very sophisticated and elegant, whereas this is, you know, more conversational, playful, engaging. So all of the signage, these characters they use. Publications, which you'll see, they have a really big digital presence. So I think one thing across hotels is that digital aspect, how they're integrating with their guests when they're not actually at the hotel, before and after, producing their own newspapers, magazines, that sort of thing, digital editions online. I think there are ways that across the board, whether it's whether it is the Hilton or other high-end hotel, different touch points that people can interact with, I think more of those will come to fruition in the next, however many years. I think a lot of them are doing it now. And I guess this is pushing everything further again, in that you're creating a selection of products that's just... Yeah. No, they do have them for sale. So they have their own personal branded products that you can buy. And that's sort of an interesting discussion point as well, whether going to a hotel rather than just going to a hotel, staying the night and then leaving, all of these elements and different things that, okay, you can take this with you, and that sort of reminds you of your stay. Or, you know, things like this become more of a, oh, this is where I stayed. And it's more of, I guess, a bragging point of, this is the hotel I stayed at, this is what I have to show you. Okay, so I'll go into sustainability. Did anyone have any other questions in relation to those sort of two hotels? Just while I'm... Yeah? Out of those two? Oh, I find that really difficult. I think I'm more excited by Citizen M in terms of what they're doing and how they're targeting a certain segment and what they're doing to interact and stay current. Whereas I think as much as I loved staying at the Nomad, I think it lacked sort of the touch points of things that you could take away with you, that experience that you're actually going there and you can take something away. Whereas I guess if you go to Citizen M, you can buy a notebook that's branded with them. And I guess it's those things, it's making those memorable experiences. And that's really that whole experience economy. People, rather than just going to a place and staying the night, it's about creating this experience. It's about giving people something, you know, and people, you know, even reviews, for example, you know, people generally, it's either good or bad, and it has to be one extreme, otherwise people may not, you know, not necessarily comment on anything. So it's really, okay, you're either exceptionally good or exceptionally bad, but at the same time, at least people are talking about you, whichever one you are. So, yeah, I think the different elements that they have in terms of being really good is what I find really interesting. In terms of for other, just general guests, or the fact that they knew that I was coming?
general guess.
I think a lot of, I'm trying to think of the experiences here. I think a lot of the Asian countries are more likely to give you a drink or give you a hot towel and things like that. Whereas here, I think it's more interested in getting your luggage and getting you settled into your room. I think that's a really, and I guess, again, interesting in that your experience when you first go there isn't that, I guess, welcoming, you know, take a seat or we'll bring you a drink or, yeah. I think a cultural thing. What I've noticed, yeah, is a cultural thing. And I think also depends on different experience. Well, depends on different travellers, which I think is a really hard one. If you're a business traveller and you just want to get into your room or you just want to, you know, start working and things like that, those sort of things play, which is why I guess a lot of the hotels now, you know, keyless entry, all of these things, you don't have to worry about that extra step of, okay, do I have this? Yeah, I agree with that. I think there's the differences between the two would be that Citizen M is basically on one, most of it is on one floor and one, so it would be, say, a room as big as this divided into sections, whereas I think that's a big difference with the Nomad in that you do have separate, okay, this is the library, this is the restaurant. They're not all in sort of the same space, which I think is a really good thing for them. But I would say that would be one of the differences. And it's not that they don't have the shared spaces, because I think they do. It's more the interaction, I think, is less there. And I think mainly probably the clientele, the cost that you're, like the amount that you're paying to actually stay there is, you know, huge in comparison to what you're staying at the Citizen. So the expectations of your experience are a lot different. And I think that's probably another key point to make is that your expectations of what it is that you're after can, you know, obviously depending on which hotel you select. And that, you know, would play a huge factor in terms of why are you choosing one hotel over the other? Are you wanting to just get in, sleep, get out? Or are you wanting to actually, okay, is there part of the neighbourhood here? Can I experience things? Is there a band? Do they have, you know, different touch points? Do they have bikes so I can go for a bike ride? Do they have their own app? You know, Hotel Americano, for example. In Chelsea, when I stayed there, they have their own app that you can download and then you can see, okay, would you like to stay in or out? And you have options of, you know, different experiences that you could have based on how you're feeling. Does that answer your... Yeah, and I think the financial aspect is obviously different to... looking at from a purely aesthetic position. But I think the financial as well in terms of sustainability is a really interesting point. I know Citizen M, for example, it's 17 minutes that the housekeeper has to clean the room. So it's all of those elements. They're the elements that create the, you know, financial bottom lines of, okay, this is how many minutes you have to clean. This is, you know, that turnover. Which is a completely different subject. So in relation to sustainability within hotels, so coincidence that I'm here, but 2017, year of sustainability week here. So I think... As I said there, so the three pillars of sustainable tourism, economic, social and environmental. And again, I think this is an interesting place for hotels to be moving into the future. So in New York last year, so 16 hotels, which consider how many hotels there are across the city is not actually a very large portion, joined the city mayor's carbon challenge to help combat climate change. So these are some of the options, I guess, that most people would know about: reusing towels that hotels do to actually try and keep themselves sustainable. Using reclaimed materials is becoming really popular. Again, looking at one hotel, one Brooklyn, sorry. They have 54% of their materials have been recycled, and they're also 100% wind powered, so the entire hotel, which that's only opened this week. So again, it's you know, an interesting subject in terms of how they're going to I think implement these different things. I know they don't sell bottled water at the hotel. They try to keep it as I guess I think they're trying to make it as green as they possibly can within, I guess, the confines of some limitations, which would be existing buildings that are already there. How do you change those to make them more sustainable? So the electric car service, powered by solar, locally produced goods, automatic lighting, there's some of the options. I'll go through, sorry, I'll just check the time. So Casa Camper, I'm not sure if you've heard of this. So Camper, the shoe brand, they have two hotels. One's in Barcelona and the other is in Berlin. So they're very much about this humane approach and respecting the environment. So all of their, all of the products that they have, the water recycling, solar energy, clean transportation. This is the building here. And you'll see here, they have little messages of, you know, walk down, it's healthier. Rather than have a mini bar in each room, they also have one floor that's devoted to food, and they have healthy food options that's all complimentary once you stay in the hotel. So I guess it eliminates another level of the chain, supply chain. And the other one was Hotel Daniel, which is in Vienna. So again, you'll see, I think a lot of the hotels will start doing their own sort of food and vegetables on the rooftops if they have them, trying to plant them, grow them, and integrating that into the restaurants. So urban gardening is what Hotel Daniel calls it. So they also have their own beehive on the roof, so the honey that they have in the store that you can purchase is also from their own. So it's a nice way, I guess, of keeping it within the same building. All right, very quickly. So a lot of this, the future of hotels, a lot of this I've sort of discussed as I've been going through it. But it's really, I guess, the hotel distinguishing themselves as, rather than just a place to sleep, but how they can distinguish themselves as an experience and their brand, how that relates to people, how they communicate with people, how the location, their architecture, their interior design, the brands that they affiliate themselves with in terms of whether it's hand wash, all of those elements, towels, whether they're branded themselves. And all of those, I guess, as a whole, put that together and that's the experience. Oh, fuck, sorry, this. So just a couple of things which I thought were quite interesting in terms of predicting how hotels will be in the future. So some of the suggestions here, not that I'm sure that these will happen, but who knows. So pillows with embedded electronics, so sleep-aiding head and neck massages, sleep suits that they can monitor your blood sugar levels and see how healthy you are, see how well you slept the night before, offer relevant dietary advice based on that. But a lot of them depend on the customer's experience and what people expect beforehand and afterwards. So whether you can configure your room before you actually arrive to have it exactly as you wanted, whether you have to actually interact with staff once you're there. I know there's a hotel that's opened up in Japan that's robotic in terms of their staff are actually robots. So you check in with a robot. I'm not entirely sure how this works. The elimination of people altogether and how that's probably one extreme example. And really, I think the main thing there is hotels trying to work towards this experience of having everything that you want under one roof, which I think different travellers, different experiences and different expectations across the board as to which hotel you stay at, that's the, you know, balancing act that people are dealing with in the hotel industry today. That's it for me. Thank you. Thank you very much for listening. Any questions? Yeah. Yeah, I think the... The Airbnb is an interesting one in terms of whether, the perception, whether it would hurt hotels because Airbnb existed. I think in a lot of ways it's a fallacy because I think the experience that you're after when you stay in a hotel is, again, a different experience if you're staying in Airbnb. And that's the, you know, I guess in an Airbnb you have no contact, you have one house or one apartment and that's it. You don't have other elements that can combine, which I think is why hotels haven't or wouldn't be so affected by Airbnb due to that different experience. Yeah, and I think the difference is that all of the sort of, whether you call them boutique, lifestyle, eco-luxury hotels, nowadays, they're trying to create that experience. So you have a sense of, they're bringing the neighbourhood in. And I guess that's really important to make your hotel distinct. I know Scandic Grand Central in Stockholm, it's all about bringing the local artists in. It's all about local bands every week. It's all about integrating the community with the hotel, and it's bringing those people in so they're coming to the hotel and experience it, whether it's the cafe or the restaurant, not just because you're staying at the hotel, but actually experiencing it because you want to stay there or for that restaurant. I think a lot of the cookie cutter approach is really what's going to be taken over. Well, already is. And I guess the example of that being true is all of these, the Marriott, all of those hotels creating these sub-brands that cater to a different experience. And I think you know, in a sense, they had to do something because they weren't getting the amount of people that they needed to fill the beds occupancy each night. So, yeah, I think cookie cutters definitely...
In terms of brand extension, what was kind of the most interesting thing that you found that they offered, and why?
From a hotel, in terms of their products?
Yeah, the kind of branded extension that they did.
Tough one. I'm trying to think. A lot of them had products, and a lot of them had things you could purchase, whether it was a gift store or things like that. There was a hotel that was in Stockholm that, as I was there and very nosy staying in the room, their bedding was actually, I'm not sure whether they knew I'd be, you know, pulling the bedding apart to actually see what the label was on the linen. But the labels on the linen was actually the hotel themselves. So it's, I guess, in that sense, it's not really a takeaway, but it's something additional that I wasn't expecting. Extending that brand to the actual products within the room itself. I couldn't think of anything else. Yeah.
I guess to speak more to that, I guess I was curious if you visited any of like the Soho House brand hotels and like members only clubs and experienced the way that they've integrated this lifestyle and members only aspect of like community as well as luxury hotels. And so I used to work there. And so like what it is, it's a members only club, and then a lot of the places have hotels, and they also have a whole line of spas, and then they have their own line. They have like, I think something like 5 different restaurants, and at each location you can experience the hotel, you can experience the members only club, you can experience the spa, and there's the restaurant. And so basically all of what you're kind of saying is right there in one location, and you dive into it as a guest, into this world that has been created for you, and almost every aspect of your trip that you might want to experience can be right there at your fingertips. So I was just curious if you happen to explore any of that.
Yeah, I haven't looked at any of the private members. I know that Soho has that, mainly probably because of their branding that didn't cross my radar. But yeah, very interesting. I think even here in the similar way, Equinox, which is your fitness here, they're opening their own hotel. I think it's 2018. And how they will do that and integrate, obviously, the same members that they have within their gyms, and creating this whole, this is the kind of person you are, this is, you're into fitness, these are all the different elements. But yeah, it's an interesting one to, see how a brand, I guess that's another topic, how a brand itself extends into different categories, even looking at, West Elm. West Elm will be opening their own hotel in 2018 as well. So from homewares to creating this whole experience. And you'll see, a lot of the fashion houses have done the same thing. Bulgari have their own Versace. So it's an interesting one when it becomes, fitness, homewares, and how that actually plays out. But yeah, I think that's an interesting... not so much necessarily that it's for private members, but I guess it's that same notion that it's for a specific group of people.
Right, totally.
A lot of hotels like Hilton, for example, the international, they want a duplicate so-called cookie cutter. In terms of boutique, they become very individualized, very... stylized. So my question is about finance part. It now become the boutique hotel, they making the brand, so are they expanding the brand? Is it become more same, for example, standard across the US? and then become international. It become another Hilton. Or my question is, are they expanding or only individualized? Like the gnome.
Yeah, I think I think I know what you're saying. Yeah, yeah, I think a lot of the boutiques, there's a smaller number of them. So yeah, similar to what you're saying about, say, the Hilton, you'll have whether it's 500 hotels worldwide. And I think that's one area which is probably yet to see in larger scales. You'll see those bigger brands with their sub brands, how that works across on an international level. But a lot of them, I think, the boutiques that boutique hotels that are in different, whether it's different states or different locations, are starting to create that personalized experience based on that location as well, rather than so they retain their independence. That's probably the one thing. So rather than having, okay, this is one hotel here, there, and they're all exactly the same, I guess the new thing with the boutique style is that they all have their different, they're all under the same umbrella, but they all have their different quirks based on where you are, which I think that would be how you would, in terms of a larger scale, like if you had the Hilton, but you had the boutique style, how you would roll that out across on a global scale.
What about the smaller one? What's their goal in the future?
Like the smaller...
Like the smaller, for example, the one in Brooklyn, what is that called?
The one I was talking about, or the Wythe, or?
What is the one in Brooklyn? The White Brooklyn, for example, what's their goal? Is it stable?
One Brooklyn?
Goal? Yeah.
Well, the owner of that is actually from, I think, Starwood. So he's... his experience and knowledge actually comes from that international global group. And I think they have about four hotels on the horizon. I think they may have one or two at the moment. But theirs is more the element of sustainability, and that's because really the owner's driving that. And he's been obviously in an area with big brands, big budgets and all of that. And I think it's more of a personal preference for him. Plus, I think it's the way that hotels have to be in the future as well.
Sorry.
Hello, Catherine. My question is, do hotels focus on more on generation factors or more of cultural, or do they focus as far as branding?
From my experience of the hotels that I've sort of researched and seen, it would be more on the cultural experience is a very big trying to, I guess, I think it's the idea of creating that experience for people, and how do you create an experience or bringing people into sort of a certain world. Mm-hmm. And that's what... you know, these hotels are trying to do is bring you into their world, but give you options to, okay, if you want to stay here, there are options. If you want to go out, there are options. These are the local things. So you really immerse yourself in that neighbourhood. So in that sense, you know, some of the hotels, it would be generational in terms of the catering towards, you know, a particular age group. But, yeah, I guess it's so... dependent on the hotel and the group themselves, which probably doesn't help. But
so I guess my question is, I'm not sure if this is going to make sense, but basically, like, you have this idea of smaller hotels and branding and everything. So, but who's, like, the driving force behind these hotels? Like, is it the interior designer? Is it a graphic designer? Is it the architect? Like, is it just the owner of the hotel? Like, who's coming up with these ideas and who's implementing it in this across-the-board kind of way that's becoming so successful? So, like, my old boss, he was an interior designer. He sort of became... the number one. As the interior designer, suddenly he became the graphic designer. He was also picking out the uniforms for the staff. And then all of this, he just got hired and hired up and up and up in the by this company that owned all these different locations that he started to make over. But, like, are you noticing a different trend in your research? Like, who's the driving force behind these things?
I think it's definitely on a case-by-case basis. Obviously, the larger the company, the harder it can be to actually implement as much creativity as you'd like to have. So that's probably a big aspect. Also, the bottom line, financials, money talks. So, you know, that's an also another issue. A lot of the, referring back to Citizen M was started by three different people, and they weren't people that had a background experience in hotels, so they were coming from a completely different perspective as well, and they were obviously the driving force. But you look at, you know, even Virgin, for example, Richard Branson, you know, you could say that he's the driving force of creating all of these different things, their own hotel, for example, now. I think it's hard within each company. You'll have somebody or key people that will be the driving force, but yeah, it's hard to sort of really pinpoint who it is.
Hi. Just wondering, what's the criteria for you in terms of deciding which country to visit, what hotel to go?
For me, it was personal preference, for all of the hotels. So it was not, it wasn't based on any amount of stars. It wasn't based on anything other than the aesthetics of their branding that I thought was of a particular standard. That was the shortlisted criteria.
Do you think hotels would ever, these type of hotels would tap into something that Marriott has done, where they've done a Marriott rewards program or a frequent member thing like that?
Yeah, I think I'm trying to think if I've seen anything that has been done in that. I'm not sure whether I've seen a lot of the boutique hotels. They don't really have that, and in that way, they don't have the membership programs in that sense. Interesting in terms of whether, I guess, if you had, for example, one that was rolled out across on an international level, and you had that many, how you actually control, I guess, the creativity within it would be an issue, and how you actually keep the people coming back to those hotels. I think, it's a difficult one, but yeah, an interesting point.
Yeah, because all I've seen is just where is it? Maybe the East Hotel or something, they would have a 30% off a night from the month of December until the end of February at a specific location, but that's the only deal or whatever I guess I've seen at a boutique hotel.
I haven't. Not that I can think of that I've come across, other than the big sort of players that I know have the rewards programs.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Is there any other hotel that does as much? I mean, they really have saturated their brand down to this product level. And their website is really fascinating because the website somehow really speaks to the fact that they do everything with technology and hip. And of course, they're trying to create an experience that even if you're not in a certain demographic, you're going to want to go there, even if you can afford something more expensive. Mm. So I think that, they seem to be trying to do that with their designs and the way they've promoted, the billboards and all of that. But I haven't really seen another hotel that does that.
The other hotel that would be, I think, similar would be Mama Shelter. Mama Shelter is in Paris. They actually have, I think, six locations now. So It was actually, when I was there, the man, his father was, I'm trying to think what it was, one of the huge players for within the hotel industry. And so he's obviously the son of him, and he started Club Med. Was it Club Med? I think his father was involved in. He's actually started these hotels, and I think they do a similar thing in terms of room size. They have a very similar, I guess, product line. They have their own products. They have a lot of interior is really high-end, probably more so than Citizen M. But that would probably be the comparison, or someone else who's doing a very similar thing to Citizen M. And I guess, you know, that was 2008, so big difference in time frame. And in many ways, I guess there's other hotels that are doing it, probably just not as on as big a scale as what Citizen M can probably afford to do. But that one would be one that I would say is quite similar. Even actually, in a, I'm trying to think. Even from a student perspective, the student hotel in Amsterdam is another one where they really incorporate the interiors and the branding, and they speak to a particular type of person. In that sense, students that are actually travelling there just to study at their university, so they have all of their accommodations that's specifically for them. And in that sense, they have a lot of branded products that are their own personal touch on them. So yeah, there are a few. And I think in that sense, it's probably more the, I don't know whether you can say luxury budget, that sort of is probably more prevalent with them, that I've come across anyhow.
Just a statistic question. Is it true, there's a saying in New York, there's a lot more hotels. Is it true, is the demand increased because the mobility or what, meaning more people can afford to travel and then airline tickets are cheaper? A lot more people talk about travels. Is that true that demand for hotel increased?
To be honest, I have absolutely no idea. But I think that would be across any industry, and that the demand is going to be increased. I think some would say with Airbnb, then the demand would decrease. But I guess at the end of the day, you look at how many hotels are being put up, and someone obviously has financial backing from a group of people and they believe that it's going to go somewhere. So in that respect, I guess you'll only know in the future how that works. But yeah, I think just growth of hotels is huge in general, whether they're financially successful or not. You know, I couldn't tell you, it would be on a you know, hotel based like basis of each particular one.
Number did increase hotel-wise across the board.
I think it would be huge. I was saying earlier today, even I was reading about the financial district, and I think there's about 7 or 8 hotels that are about to be put into that area. Hudson Yards, they're putting, I think one of the Equinox hotels is going there. So yeah, I think there's definitely huge demand, and it's by different, I guess, players nowadays, whereas before it was traditional people with a hospitality background. Now it's people like Equinox who are in the fitness industry that are now, okay, let's create a hotel, let's create a brand for that. So yeah, I think it would be increasing. It's just a different, different basis of... No, so I had a list of probably, it must have been over 150 different hotels and their branding and different elements, some that I hadn't seen their branding but thought based on what I had, whether it was a sign or something, that they may have an extensive brand, like collateral across the entire scope of the hotel. In that sense, I sort of narrowed those down to they may have only had one or two not necessarily just cohesive, but one or two elements that were working together, whereas the whole picture wasn't sort of working. So those ones would be eliminated. Nothing was to do with luxury or the amount of stars they had. It really was personal aesthetics of who I was looking at or who I thought was actually showing something that was more interesting than, say, someone else. So that's how it was sort of narrowed down to the 30 or so that are in the book. Yeah, so rather than just one element, it was, from their stationery to their signage, to things like, their bedding, the soap elements, who they align themselves with in terms of shampoos and conditioners, all of those sort of things. Okay, who's actually creating more of this experience? Who's integrating the branding as the whole hotel rather than just as a separate element? Okay, we have this shell of a place. We have the place looking great, amazing architect, amazing interior designer. Graphic design, we'll just get some sort of simple logo, put it there, and then put it on the envelope, put it on the business card, and splash it across the place in the same spot. And that sort of, that was what I was avoiding. And that's what I guess, came to find with a lot of the high-end sort of hotels that people know the names of. That's their methodology. That's how they do things. Because the people that are going there aren't maybe necessarily as interested in the design aspect as what the smaller boutique hotels are. And I guess people's interest in art and design's increased over the last 10 years to that being more important to people today.
Divana, because you were mentioning about them growing their own food. I think that was in Berlin. But is there anything geographical in terms of, like, are people in Berlin or Germany more interested, or Canada, in, really showing these trends toward sustainability and sort of becoming its own ecosystem? Or is it just across the board?
I think it's quite, not that I would say new, but I think it's a relatively, in my experience of the hotels that I went to, there were little pieces of sustainability shown within the hotel, but as a cohesive, this is our plan, this is whatever, then it's a relatively new thing. I know that earlier how I said about Virgin Hotels, Richard Branson, I know that he has a very big, they do every day, I think they work out how much they've actually offset with staying there. They donate any of the leftover soap that's in the hotel, that all goes to a donation so they can, it's very much related to sustainability and how they can improve it, similar to what I was saying about the One Brooklyn. But those are really new hotels and new experiences that are doing it across the board, whereas I think the ones where I was looking, say even in the last 2 or 3 years, the emphasis wasn't as great as what I think it is now.
And the one in Dumbo, though, it's wind powered?
Yeah, it's wind powered.
So
I'm not entirely sure how that works, but it's 100% wind powered.
And it's
so
open.
And I'm pretty sure it opened this week. I know it was end of February. So yeah, I haven't actually seen it. But yeah, I think that would be an interesting one to.
The other thing is Airbnb has kind of been made illegal here.
Yeah. And
so you heard that, but is it New York the only one that has managed to pull that little piece of politics off?
I'm not sure. New York is the only one I know of. But I think it's been illegal here for many, many years. So I think, has it not? I thought it had been for many years, and then it's only recently that I think you're allowed to, if you stay for more than 30 days or something like that in one home, then it's not illegal, but you have to have that consecutive. That was my understanding anyhow. It was over 30 days in New York, then you could stay in an Airbnb. If it was any shorter than that, then that was from memory, that's what I was. Yeah.
Just one quickie question. Is there a book too? some other places you want to explore, different types of hotels and marketing schemes, say, even with Marriott buying all these other different hotels, what do they do with the previous branding? Do they marry them together for people who are brand loyal, like W? You know, the people, are they going to go over to Marriott, but they didn't like Marriott, but they like W?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting one. The process of actually publishing a book can be quite extensive, as I've learnt. So it's one of those elements where future things that I've thought, whether it should be a digital platform rather than a print, just due to the time factor, and also the immediacy. So obviously publishing online, you can do it immediately. Printing, you still have to wait. So yeah, there will be something. I'm just not entirely sure what it will be yet. I think the hotels, branding, that sort of thing is the area that I really enjoy. I've also been teaching, so that side of things I've been really loving. So it's, I guess, keeping I don't know, I seem to always have a few things going at the same time, which is, I guess, that entrepreneurial spirit of such. So yeah, finishing my master's, whether I create something that's more of a tangible thing rather than just a book, it may be. I'm probably not, but it wouldn't put me it past me to want to. Any investors are around. That's something I would definitely love to do.